Good evening, everybody. Good to be in the Lord's house. Welcome, welcome. I hope everybody is doing well. And I don't know about you, but I'm enjoying this weather. The good Lord's giving us a little better than what we had last week. But it is good to be in the Lord's house tonight with the people of God. And so we greet you. I've got a number of prayer needs we want to bring before the Lord tonight. And I know you have some here. So if you'll allow me to let me, Brother Larry, can I have that thing? Let me make sure we don't have anything we do. One of the main announcements is certainly going to be the, let me find it. Just get your bulletin and keep up with everything, okay, so I don't have to read all these here. This community benefit gospel singing that we're having for Zach Martin, and it's February the 10th, and these two groups will be here, Dawson Road and His Redeemed. Love offering is going to be received, and I know we got a lot of other projects going on. The ladies will be selling, ladies ministry will be selling those Easter egg hearts and things, and I'll let their, there we go. Look at that, white chocolate and Valentine. What did I say, Easter? Ain't no telling what I said. Okay. Thank you, sister. Sister Yvonne is so prompt in picking. I'm just messing with you. You are right. That's all right. Alley Good Church of God, Valentine peanut butter hearts. They're $6 each. You can go ahead and order these. These are the decorations they're going to put on it. They're made from scratch by hand with love. And I actually sampled some of the white chocolate this afternoon just to make sure it was okay with all you. And it was. It passed the test. So that is going, what they're doing here is raising money. Sister Kim, that's to cover your budget on the ladies' ministry conference, the annual conference. So they're doing that to raise money so it don't cost the church anything. Just raise the money, pay the speaker, buy the food, do all of that. So I think that's a wonderful thing. Please be aware of that. The gospel benefit sing, February the 10th. We wanted you to be reminded of that. Also going to have a silent auction at the singing, too, and we'll be getting with you a little bit longer. If you want to donate something to this silent auction, that would be amazing. Peanut Butter Hearts, Grief Share Group at our church beginning February the 6th through May the 7th. Each session is Tuesday from 6:30 to 8:30. Please see Sister Yvonne, be leading the sessions. Do you have any questions about that? And I believe you've had a church that's going to be referring. Did Zach call you today? And So those that didn't hear, Covenant Church is going to refer all of their Grief Share people this time to us because they're not able to have it, and so we are having it. I think that's amazing. That's a great. Right. Amen. Amen. So we're just thankful that it's expanding and people's heard about it, and we appreciate that. Young at Heart's coming up February the 15th. East North Carolina Women's Conference, March 15th. That's down the road a little bit. Grief Share. Just want to make sure. Sunday, we don't have a flyer for this, but we're not having church here this Sunday night. Snow Branch, and I do apologize for the late announcement, but Snow Branch Church of God is in revival, and when we have revivals on the district that are close enough, they cancel and come over to be with us. We're going to cancel and go over there and be with them. So that doesn't mean you stay home and watch it on Facebook. That means you get in your car and drive to Snow Branch. Michael Ball will be there to preach, and so we're excited about that. So that's this Sunday night only. One night, we'll be right back here Sunday morning and then the following Wednesday night. No change there. This Friday, movie night. Family movie night here in the Fellowship Hall. They'll be watching Joseph, King of Dreams. Doors will be open at 6:30. They'll have concessions, too. So please be aware of that. And our middle school and high school students are going to the Unite rally, student rally in the Greenville Church of God on January 27th. And if your child plans to attend, the church fan will be leaving our church at 6:15 and be returning at 10 p.m. And then... Okay, that's enough. That's enough announcements. We'll catch you up to date. I did want to just make you aware of the Easter. Valentine's hearts and make you aware Sunday night that we're not having church here, but we'll be having it over there at the, with the good folks of Snow Branch Church of God. So moving on to the prayer needs tonight, Brother Jim says, remember Larry Jones, Alda's husband's had a procedure today, and we want to pray and agree and believe that the biopsy will be negative. Brother Jim also says his uncle Kenneth Matthews is in the hospital with a concussion and needs prayer. Jeff and Terry called in. They're headed to Greenville. Jeff's aunt that he's kind of got power of attorney over and taking care of, because I believe she's deaf, and she's in the hospital. She's fallen, so please remember her. Her name's Edna Perry. Sister Terry says, please continue to pray for her shoulder. There's been two deaths in families that they're aware of, the Moore family and the Perry family, so remember that. I've got written down here, remember Zach Martin and Shirley Berry. Sister Yvonne says, Buddy is sick and needs prayer, and Angie's not feeling well. Sister Crystal sends a prayer request in and says, Randall Modlin is in the hospital with sepsis. We want to remember him. Randall's a friend of mine I grew up with in Williamston, and I believe it's Sister Jeannie's first cousin. So we want to remember Brother Randall here tonight, and also to pray for Tool, that he's in a lot of pain is the thing here. So we want to remember, I'm assuming that's going to be related to that procedure that it has. So we certainly hate to hear that tonight, and we want to remember him. Remember, Sister Kim and I would travel Saturday up to Southfield, Virginia, to do a funeral for a dear, dear friend of ours. We pastored at Warrington. He was my Sunday school superintendent and also one of my pastoral council members. And I went to see her Monday, and we had a chance to pray with the family. And she died Tuesday morning, about 8 o'clock in the morning. And their daughter has cancer, and if God don't intervene, we just need a miracle there. So it's a sad, sad situation, and I just ask for I covet your prayers as your pastor, that God will give me the wisdom and the knowledge and what to say and how to conduct myself as we go up there to minister into that situation. So we covet your prayers in that. On that note, I'd like to open it up now. If there's anyone here on the platform out here that has a special need that they want to bring before the Lord tonight, any outspoken needs, family of your brother-in-law, Brother Mills' brother-in-law, I cannot remember his name.
Rasco
Gillum, right? Rasco Gillum. Let's remember the family of Rasco Gillum. Anybody else tonight? Remember that. Brother Charles. Amen. Amen. It's good. Thank you, Brother Charles. It's good with all this news. It's good to hear some good news. And I'm telling you, people, We keep praying like this and keep seeking the face of the Lord. I'm telling you, people are calling in. They're sending emails. We're getting texts. We're getting Facebook requests. People are calling our church and contacting our church because they want us to pray. And that's a burden, but also it's a privilege, amen, because it is a privilege to take our needs to the Lord in prayer. So, amen. Anybody else? Praise the Lord. We're going to ask you to stand, and why don't we go ahead and do this? Why don't we pray, and instead of us getting you up and down four or five times like we usually do on Wednesday nights, we're going to pray. We're going to ask you to come and give in the offering after we pray, then go back and stand up, and we'll just sing until it's time for me to preach, okay? Is that all right? Would you join me in prayer tonight? Heavenly Father, Lord, we all have needs, Lord God, tonight. We all bring our petitions to you, Lord. We bring them to a throne of grace, a throne of mercy, a place, Lord, where we know that the God of heavens sits upon a throne, and Jesus on the right hand of the Father ever liveth to make intercession for the saints of God. Lord, we are indeed a people that is needing. We need you to move, Lord, upon these prayer requests, Lord, that represent serious needs, Lord, every one of them. Procedures, surgeries, recovering, Lord. There's death and dying, Lord, here, representative here, Lord. God, there's nothing too hard for you, Lord. So we as the people of God, we extend our prayers. And Lord, we accept this burden as intercessors. We accept this burden as a church, Lord, a people. Lord God, just regular people that have a faith, a supernatural faith in a God that's able to move and that you'll hear our voice. So Lord, take this time tonight, this service, bless it for your glory. Lord, we bring again our young people in the back, Lord, tonight, God, as that you're conducting, they're conducting classes. Teach our young people, our teenagers, Lord, raise them up in the fear and the admonition of the Lord, God. Bless this offering now, God, as we begin to give tonight to the work of the Lord. Bless the song, the worship, the praise. We pray, Lord, that you'll bless the preaching and teaching of the Word of God. And Lord, as before we leave, we'll gather in this altar. We'll make our petitions, our supplications, our requests known unto you again, Lord. Would you lift your hands and bless the God of heaven tonight just a minute, just a moment in time as we create a sacred place for God to just come down and minister to us. We take this time, Lord, and bless you. We take this time to magnify you, Lord. We take this time to bless the God of heaven. Oh, we thank you, Lord, today. We worship you, Lord, today. Thank you, Lord. Bless you, Lord. Magnify you, God. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you step out, amen, and give in the work of the Lord down here at the very back? God bless you.
Tonight, let's sing a song we're all very familiar with and just worship the Lord.
Thank you.
Give the Lord praise tonight. Amen. In his house tonight. Amen. Thank y'all tonight. Amen. Blessed be the... Y'all can be seated. Amen. We appreciate you and our praise team and choir. Amen. I love that song, as you can tell. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. I don't have a whole lot of sense. I get up a lot of time first thing in the morning. I just begin to say, bless the Lord. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that's within me. Bless his holy name. I'm bumbling and stumbling down the hallway looking at that coffee pot. Amen. But I can say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. I bless you, Lord, today. You've been good to your people. Let's go to 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 18 first. Going to do this. I got one more after tonight, one more Wednesday night, and we're going to finish up. We're not done with prayer. We're just kicking it off. We're lifting it up. Amen. We're lifting off. How many of you ever seen, when I was a young boy, the Apollo space, Apollo rockets or whatever, spacecraft lift off? Amen. You remember that? Young boys, they were sending men to moon. We were captivated back in the late 60s and early 70s to our TV sets. The young folks don't remember this, of course. There was three channels, ABC, NBC, and CBS. And on a good night, PBS out of Columbia. Y'all come on and say amen. And that was all we had. And we were glued to our TV sets to watch those rockets power into outer space and land a man on the moon and beat Russia to the punch. Amen. When I'm telling you tonight, amen, Alley Good Church of God, we've lifted off in January of 2024. We're seeking greater heights and deeper depths in the things of God. And I'm not just saying that's not hype, amen. We're going places, amen. We want to see the kingdom of God manifest and come in power and glory, signs and wonders, miracles, salvation experiences, sanctification, baptism in the Holy Ghost. Come on, somebody, amen, amen. Want to see that take place, and amen, it'll come because of people praying, and I believe that with all my heart. Now, we're going to preach tonight for a little while. We're in our prayer series, and we were going to talk about spiritual warfare, because I'm telling you, when a church begins to pray, really begin to pray, we have fired the shot across the bow. We have given notice to the enemy that something's different about us. We're a good church, and I know that good people love the Lord and seen a lot of great things in the history of the 100 plus years now, Valley Good Church of God. But I believe, and I believe it was prophesied just recently in our services, that God wants to do some things that we've never even seen or could even imagine here, and God wants to accomplish things. But with those great declarations of and standing on the Word of God and great faith rising up and prayers being lifted up, and we are mobilizing prayer and we're mobilizing intercessors, and we're believing God for the community, for the city, for our families, for the prodigals, renewal, restoration, revival, and on and on and on with things that we're targeting this year, prodigals again, and all of these things. But when you declare these things and you start in these, remember there is an enemy. There is an enemy. And he's not going to lay down, people of God, but praise be unto God. That doesn't scare us, amen, that we should be inspired, because we know that the one that we work for, the one that we labor for, the one that we serve, that one day we want to see face to face, is with us. And if God be for us, who can be against us? Amen. 1 Timothy 1 and 18, this charge I commit unto thee, son, Timothy, according to the prophecies that went on before thee. Timothy had great, you know, we know the story here, mother and grandmother, great heritage in the kingdom of God and in the gospel. He said that thou by them mightest war a good warfare. So what he's saying to a young man that he's mentoring, what he's saying to his protege, this man that will kind of take the mantle, if you will, from the Apostle Paul, he said, you're going to war a good warfare. There's going to be battles coming. And see, I probably, again, what I love about all of you, especially on Wednesday night, you people are Bible scholars and Bible people that study the Word of God and dig into the Word of God. And you know that what I'm saying tonight is an absolute biblical truth, that we're in a battle. We're in a battle. This is a war. This is warfare. These terms, when you look these terms up in their original meaning, warfare means a military campaign. There's no doubt that it's, some people say they like to make it a metaphor. Oh, we're in a battle. No, we're in a real battle. This is not a metaphor. This is not an example. This is not an illustration. No, we're in a warfare, and there are things that are set in motion from the moment we're up, get up in the morning, probably all night long too, but from the moment we get up in the morning, there are forces that work against us. And if you're not doing anything for the kingdom of God, if you're not a threat to the kingdom, to the kingdom of darkness, then the enemy leaves people alone because he doesn't have anything to fear. But when you step out beyond what is the normal, what is the average, we want to walk in the extraordinary. We want to walk in the supernatural because what we're in is supernatural. The very thing that we do, we don't walk in the flesh. We walk in the Spirit. Amen. We don't war in the flesh. We war in the Spirit. For the weapons, and I'm getting ahead of myself, but we'll use this scripture in a minute. For the weapons of our warfare, they're not fleshly. They're not something we can pick up and bop somebody over the top of the head with. The weapons of our warfare, they're not carnal, but they're mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. How many of you know there are strongholds? Strongholds of addiction, strongholds of lust, strongholds of jealousy, strongholds of all kinds of sin and addiction, just on and on again. These strongholds, amen. And so the only way that you can fight, you know, you can fight these is through these weapons and this warfare we're talking about. I don't watch much television. Our TV may be on and it's on Andy Griffith, and we found a channel on some kind of streaming service where it just plays Andy Griffith 24 hours a day, nonstop, 9 days a week. I know every episode by heart except the color ones. I don't watch them. And I stumbled on something the other day, and I looked, and there was a show called Intervention. And I'm not really that familiar with it, but every one of those shows has a person who's bound by alcohol or drugs, and it's pitiful, y'all. These people are, I'm absolutely pitiful. And the family gets together, and they work, and with the help from the TV producer. I don't know all of it. But I'm just telling you, the people are so bound up. I watched an episode. It was about 15 minutes. I watched an episode of it. And if there was any bad words, I think they beeped it out. I didn't hear any because that's kind of the cutoff for me. I'm just not going to listen. I come out of the world. Okay, anyway. You know, I know Christians, some Christians like to watch movies. They got all kind of cussing in it. And I thought, wow, take the Lord's name in it and everything, and you can watch it. Anyway, that's a preaching for another day. So I was watching it, and the guy was addicted to hand sanitizer. He drank it, bottles of it, every day. And so, and I don't know the statistics or the measurements, but liquor has a certain amount, 10%, 20% alcohol in it. Hand sanitizer has 60-80% alcohol in it. I use a lot of hand sanitizer, church folk, but I ain't never drank none. But I watched him drink it, bottles of it, and it get him just as drunk as the man at the bar. Matter of fact, he said, for $1.79, I can get just as drunk if I spend $100 in a bar. And I watched this man, and I thought, and he's lost everything that he has. He lost his wife, his children, his job, his career, his savings. He's moved back in with his mama. And I watch this whole thing, and I'm thinking, that's a stronghold, people. You know, I understand. I'm not condoning anything. I can understand people going to the liquor store on 4th of July. I get it. People do it. I'm in the grocery store. They got cases of beer. They're celebrating Memorial Day and 4th of July. Sinners, come on here. Sinners do what sinners do. And they're bound and they're bound in sin. But when I'm watching a grown man who's lost everything that he has, and he is so bad off, he's drinking hand sanitizer. And I'm thinking, God, these are just the type of people that need the power of God manifested in their lives. Come on, somebody, and say amen. This is a spiritual battle. Do you think for a moment that man wants to throw everything away in his life and drink? I could not believe it for the life of me. And so I pray. I said, God, help us as the church to realize
that there is a real devil fighting a real battle, addicting and chaining our people down, putting hooks in their noses. That man's got a hook in his jaw. And every time the devil wants to snatch on it, he snatches on it. But, they sent him off somewhere, and he'd been clean a couple of years, a month. I don't remember the details. But I can tell you the blood of Jesus, amen, can set that man free. Come on, somebody, and see. Let's give the Lord praise. He can tonight, amen. So we're in a battle. So here Timothy's being told by the great man of God, you're getting ready to war, a good warfare. And so now for 2,000 years, and for really for 6,000 years since Adam and Eve, the forces of evil have been against the forces of good, the kingdom of darkness against the kingdom of light. We see in Corinthians, I believe it's 4 and 4, 1 Corinthians 4 and 4, where it talks about the God of this world, little g, the God of this world system is better translated there, has blinded them lest they believe the glorious gospel. Their eyes would be open. There is a devil that blinds men and women. We see in the parable of the sower, how diabolical that you could go and hear the word of God and it get in. And the Bible said that the enemy comes in and swoops down and steals it. And another illustration there is that they hear the word of God and for a little while they grow. But then the cares of this world and the thorns and the weeds of this world come in. The devil hates any time that we move closer to God. I'm going to tell you something I want you to help me pray with. We've got some younger folks in this church, and they're getting in here, and they're trying to get rooted, and I'm telling you, they're fighting a battle. Come on, help me now. Don't be nosy wanting to know who it is and what's going on. Just say, God, we stand with these people. We stand with them, and we're standing on the rock with them, and amen. We're going to believe, amen. We're going to help them fight, amen. Look, I heard a preacher, I borrowed it, and I'll borrow it again, amen. This ain't a cruise ship. This is a battleship, this ship of Zion. Hey, if we're going to make it, we're going to have to battle. And we can't sit back and say, well, let's let this other group battle the devil, amen. No, we're in the army of God, amen. I'm a soldier marching forward in victory, amen. I want to do all that I can do for the kingdom of God while there's breath in this body. So there's a battle against the unseen forces behind the evil in this world. And you look. I know the works of the flesh are real. Come on. The Bible lists them. We can get in the flesh, and we know that things proceed out of the human heart. There's wickedness there. I don't believe that there's a devil behind. Conversation I had, somebody said, well, my tire went, I had a flat tire, I would have made it to church, but the devil gave me a flat tire. No, you've had that same set of tires on for 180,000 miles, and every one of them showing steel. Come on now. Then when it goes flat, you want to say it's the devil's fault. No, it's not. You just did, and I've been in church services with the sound system gets to crackling and squealing and everything. Somebody says, "Oh, let's pray the devil's in the sound system." No, it's an analog system that Grandpa bought in 1940 from the thrift store. Come on. But I can tell you, we everything's not the devil, but I can tell you one, the flip side of that is a lot of times that joker will slip around and he'll poke and prod, cause things to happen, and a lot of time we don't recognize. The Bible says that we need to be harmless as doves and wise as serpents. We need to recognize when the enemy is at work. God, give us discernment during it. Pray that way. Remember, I'm talking about a prayer series here, how prayer is vital in spiritual warfare. You cannot do, if we do spiritual warfare, we cannot do it without praying. God, give us discernment to see when it is the enemy, when the enemy is using somebody, when it's just not somebody having a bad day. Your wife gets up, your husband gets up, and he's ill, and yeah, the devil's got a hold of you. Well, it may not be the devil. He may just didn't sleep good last night. But then be able to recognize when the devil is trying. Because, the devil hates marriage. Anybody ever notice that? Between a man and a woman, the devil hates it. The devil hates the nuclear family, a man, a woman, and children. He hates that. And that's why he's attacked it in the way that he has. He despises God's design for humanity. You think about this war in that we're thank God that you people have grabbed a hold of the vision that I have for the pregnancy center. We are in a battle. Every day there is a battle going on. The devil, the unseen, evil, wicked forces behind, they are messing with the minds of these young ladies and these women, trying to convince them to take the life of these unborn children. Come on now. And what stands in the gap? We do, the church does. I was praying about the involvement with the pregnancy center, and congratulations to our own Ann Harris, who's been elected as the vice chair for the pregnancy center. We appreciate Sister Ann. Why don't y'all give her a hand? Amen. So we're standing in the gap, and we're taking a stand, not on our watch, devil. We'll do everything we can to snatch every abortion-minded woman who's the enemy. Because I'm telling you right now, it might be a boyfriend that don't want to take responsibility. It might be a set of parents that say, you know, we don't want the shame of an unwed mother in our family and a baby born out of wedlock. But I can promise you, behind every time that those choices are being made, there's a devil. There's a demon that wants a child destroyed, because human beings are created, what? In the image of God. I'm telling you, it's an unseen evil wickedness around every corner. I'm not trying to scare you tonight. I'm not trying to get you to go home and look in the closet door, look under the bed, but you have a real enemy, amen? And there's a devil out there. Saints, this is to remind us that there is a battle, and that the war doesn't stop until you die, or we get raptured. I want to get raptured. I don't know about you. Paul, what did Paul say at the end of his life? I fought a good fight. He said, I've kept the faith. And that's why a lot of times preaching and churches, and, you know, I was listening to the Sunday school lesson. I believe it was Sister Patricia was teaching and exhorting the saints not to forsake the assembling of ourselves together as we see the day approaching. We know the Lord's coming back, and it sometimes the preaching and the teaching has to be to exhort the saints. I'm here to exhort you. We're going to win this battle. I'm here to encourage you tonight, but I'm here to tell you that there is a battle. There's an unseen force behind the evil that is in this world. Amen? Daniel, we can look. Let's look at a few Old Testament illustrations here. Job teaches us that there's a calculated, convoluted plan, sophisticated plan of the enemy. If you want to learn something about spiritual warfare, I want you to just look at the way the enemy approaches it. The Bible says that when the sons of God come and met before God, and I'll paraphrase all of this, I can't quote it anyway, they came and the devil shows up. And the Lord says, have you considered my servant Job? While time won't allow, it would take hours to unpack all of this, and you can study it for yourself. There is God. Have you considered my servant Job? But we can see behind the scenes that the enemy then has permission. And I love this. The devil can't go but so far, because God's got him on a leash. He can't do but so much, amen. And God allowed, and there's a lot more to be taught and preached here, and I understand there's so many layers in the book of Job and what Job went through, but I'm focusing on the spiritual warfare aspect of it. The enemy attacked this man. He attacked his family. He attacked, and his children died. He attacked his wife. The devil messed with the wife's mind. What did she say? Why don't you just curse God and die? Wow. Thanks, honey, for the encouragement. There he has been attacked by the enemy. And I'm telling you, and I've got this in my notes, but let me go ahead and skip to it now. The mind is a place, probably the number one place, where the enemy gets people. Because Brother Willie, he's a good sport. I'll use him. Brother Willie said, Brother Bateman, I'd like to talk to you after church. We talk. And he says something. I don't really understand what he said. And I go home and I say, wonder what he meant by that. Wonder what he meant. So the right thing to do, he's a brother in the Lord, and I'm a brother in the Lord, to call and say, Brother Willie, I don't understand that. But the enemy will use that if I don't do that and you know, say, Brother, what did you mean by that? I can sit there and think on that thing. Next thing I know, the enemy get in my thoughts, and I begin to think, well, wonder what he meant by that. The enemy will mess with our mind. Should I go here? I'm going. Deep dive. People say, well, preacher, we paid a preacher too much. He needs to get a job. Then he gets a job. Well, he's working too much. He's neglecting the church. And then, you know, instead of what we really ought to do, and none of y'all said that. I know that. I know better than that. But just in case you did, why don't we just do this? Instead of letting the devil put thoughts like that in our mind and undermine what we're trying to do, whether it's me or whoever, whatever. And that has happened. I don't know if it's ever happened to you here or me or Brother Jethro or whoever's been here. But let me say this. Why don't we do this and say, no, you know what? I'm going to pray for my pastor. He's leading us in this battle. He's the head soldier on the front lines. I'm going to partner with him, and I'm going to pray hedge of protection, and I'm going to think good thoughts on him, and I'm going to encourage. Come on, yeah, that's right, you know. And it's amazing. I've had conversations, and I've gone away, and I said, wonder what that meant. Wonder what it meant. It's like a text. You read a text and. My wife sometimes said, well, what do you think she meant? I don't know. I finally called people. They're texting me back and forth. I said, let me tell you something. I can talk a whole lot faster than I can text. So let's talk. Text is fine. I'll meet you at Cracker Barrel at 10 o'clock. I get that. But if we want to talk, we don't know how to interpret them sometimes. And that's why we don't understand. The enemy will use anything he can in conversations. And the way in the way we think, and the way things appear to us, and the Lord wants peace and harmony, and that's why. And I'm so far ahead of myself, so I'm not going to get to all this tonight. That's why the Lord says in Ephesians 6, and we will read that before we leave, to put on the helmet of salvation, to cover your mind. Enemy, you know, you get ready to pray for somebody. And it's a terminal situation, okay? And if you know, we've been in these situations before, if God doesn't touch that person, God doesn't heal them, then they're not going to make it. Come on. We stand in faith and pray. Anybody ever prayed and said, and you heard the voice of the enemy, God ain't going to heal them? Shut up, devil. Whether God heals this person or not, I'm praying in the name of Jesus. I'm standing on the word of God. I know God can. We pray, and I believe Brother Kenny would go a lot with different times. And when Gerald Wayne was dying, and we'd pray. And one of the last times I prayed with him, that man had faith. That man walked in faith. He encouraged me. Even dying, he encouraged me. I said, Brother, I'm praying for you. I'm not giving up. I'm praying that God heal you. And Gerald looked at me. He said, I don't know whether God will heal me, but I know he can. Come on. That's good. Man, that's good stuff. That's faith. And the enemy said, oh, no, look what happened. No, I'm going to tell you. What happens is God is sovereign. And we're going to stand on the word of God. We're going to believe that the blood of Jesus Christ still cleanses. We're going to believe, amen, that you can still lay hands on the sick. You can anoint with oil. You can pray the prayer of faith. That's the word of God. Devil, you are a liar. We stand on the word of God. That's faith. Devil, you're a liar. You're the reason there's unbelief. You're the reason doubt creeps in. We stand, we declare, and boldly declare, amen, the Lord God is Jehovah Rapha, the Lord God that healeth thee. Dear God, sometimes people get so far gone in drugs and dope and mess. Oh, there just ain't no hope. Yes, there is. So Job teaches us that there's a calculated, convoluted plan. I don't have time. I just do not have time. Daniel's praying and fasting 21 days. Anybody remember 21-day fast, prayer and fasting? Okay. Daniel's praying. While he's praying for 3 weeks, there is a war in the heavenlies. There are things going on in the heavenlies that we're not allowed to see unless God pulls the curtain back. So for 21 days, Daniel's fasting and praying, waiting on an answer. Angel shows up. I'm paraphrasing. The angel of the Lord shows up and says, Daniel, God heard you the first time you prayed, right at the beginning. He said, but I've had to fight the prince of of Persia for the last 21 days to get here and get you a message. Sometimes you have to persevere, fast, and pray. I don't understand. I've read that story, that account in the Bible, and I've read in a story where one angel of the Lord killed 180,000 Assyrians. And you and I both know that that angel, Michael the archangel, could have probably took the prince of Persia, and said, and been done with him. But that's not the way God chose. I believe God unveiled briefly to let us see behind the unseen world that there are battles going on in the heavenlies. Principalities, powers, rulers of darkness, spiritual wickedness. Where? High places. There's this unseen thing. And so why did it take 21 days? I don't know. But it took 21 days of prayer and fasting by one of the men in the Bible that nothing is spoken evil of. One of the greatest men in the history of the Word of God, Daniel. Bar none. He's up there at the top. I know Jesus said the least is the greatest. I know how that works. But as far as looking at great men of God, that's one of the greatest men of God that's ever lived on planet Earth. In all the annals of history. Now you hear me. He had to fast and pray for 21 days to get an answer from God. Oh, what he received from the Lord. But you know what? He had to battle. What if Daniel would have said, you know what? I'm going to go get a chicken leg. I'm done with this fast. We're not going to talk so much about fasting. But there is these battles. And so when you shoot the bow across the bow, you say, hey, this is the first shot. We're seeing it. And I believe that's what the 21 days of prayer and fasting here is. We started 2024. Time will slip by. This year will be gone in a minute. It'll be over with. And you'll be 1 year older, like myself. And I'm telling you right now, I believe God is awakening in us a warrior spirit to fight the good fight of faith. Amen? Come on and say amen. You'll say amen a little bit better. We'll get done. The Bible clearly teaches that there is spiritual warfare and importance of prayer in this battle. Now, I want to go, let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 10. We'll read 3 and 4, then I'll close with Ephesians 6 and 18. And then I know everybody here knows, years ago, one of the first things I did was, one of the first passages of Scripture I ever learned was this passage, Ephesians chapter 6, 10 through 18. I wanted to be able to memorize it and quote it, and I can still quote it, but as I've gotten older, sometimes I leave out words and add words in there, so y'all bear with me. But here, Paul, again, speaking to the Corinthian church. Now listen, though we walk in the flesh, that speaks to our carnality, that speaks to our human aspect of us. We're in the flesh. We're human beings. We are flesh. He said, but do we do not what? War. After the flesh. This is not a fleshly battle. That's where we miss it. Come on, help me now. That's why when churches get in a fuss with each other and a church splits, that's flesh. Because they've taken a battle that they should have fought in the spirit and got the victory over and let the flesh win. That's why when people get mad in the church and fall out with one another, it's a result of not allowing, not having discernment, not praying. And Pastor, and let me tell you, Brother Bateman, speaking about myself in the third person here, I have a very, very simplistic view of confrontation in the church. You ready for it? I don't believe there's nothing that me, you, and the Holy Ghost can't get worked out. That's simple. Y'all didn't get that. I'll say it again. I don't believe that there's nothing can come between us, no issue, no problem, that me, you, and the Holy Ghost can't get worked out. That we can sit down, pray about it, fast about it, seek the Lord, come to an understanding. Doesn't mean we have to agree on every single point of everything, but we can come to an agreement. I love you, you love me, we love God, we're moving forward in the kingdom. Come on. Now, this is spiritual here. You can't do that in the flesh. So Paul's clearly saying here, our weapons, what we do is not after the flesh. We cannot fight the devil in the flesh. Remember the seven sons of Sceva. Let's go to verse 4. Then we'll go to Ephesians 6 and 18 and we'll try to wrap up. For our weapons of our warfare, this is a military campaign, they're not carnal. They're not of the flesh. You can't fight the devil with a gun, a bow, an arrow, nothing. But our weapons, they're mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. So I talked about, I used a crazy illustration earlier. That poor man addicted, a drunkard, an alcoholic addicted to drinking hand sanitizer. It is pitiful, pitiful, y'all. It's pitiful. But our weapons, that what we're going to fight something like that with, it's not rehab. It's not talking somebody out of it. Amen. It's the weapons of our warfare, not carnal, but they're mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Things that hold people, that bind people, that crush people, that eventually will kill people and drag their souls to hell. We have the weapon. What are the weapons? Well, I'm glad you asked, amen. This word, weapons, is primarily, now get you ready for this? It primarily means offensive, on the offense. Too long the church has been on the defense. We need to get on the offense. The weapons that we have, we can use them to fight with. So number one weapon I'm going to talk about briefly, I'm going to hit on these and we'll move on, is prayer. One of the greatest, when prayer is not a discipline, it is a delight. I know it's a discipline. Prayer, fasting, reading the Word of God, studying the Word of God, all these things are disciplines that make us better Christians. But prayer becomes a delight when we seek the face of the Lord. We have access to God. We pray and God hears and moves and responds. So one of the greatest weapons that the church has is prayer. Come on, everybody, and say amen. Number two, another one that we have. Oh, my goodness. Woo! Oh, my goodness. I love God's Word. Don't y'all? But it's quick and powerful, sharper than a two-edged sword. Ephesians, Paul's going to call it the sword of the Spirit. The devil despises the Word of God. That's why he twists the Word of God. That's why he misinterprets the Word of God. That's why he creeps into churches that are backslidden, apostate, and they preach false doctrine. They take the Word of God and twist it to mean things it never mean. And you know, the devil even quoted the Word of God to Jesus in the wilderness and misapplying the Word of God. He hates the Word of God because he knows how powerful it is. Man cannot live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. I'm telling you, it's time for the Alley Good Church of God and you people to start speaking God's Word, proclaiming God's Word, standing on God's Word, singing God's Word, praying God's Word, amen, believing on God's Word. Come on, somebody, and give me an amen. This is one of the greatest weapons known to mankind, the Word of God. Woo! Another weapon is Christ's victory at the cross. At the cross where I first saw the light. Christ's victory is enforced by a Bible-believing, church that is on the march. Amen. We don't come here in our own victory, but what Jesus Christ did on the cross, how he can take a wretched sinner and turn him into a saint of God that loves God, a praying, sanctified, set apart, spirit-filled man or woman of God. Dangerous. We don't come, like David said, with a sword or a spear, but we come in the name of the Lord God Most High. Come on, somebody. These are powerful weapons. We are not left to ourselves. The devil is a liar. The devil is defeated. Amen. I've read the end of the book. Last one. I got as many weapons. The last one is heaven's sweet Holy Ghost. God said, Jesus said, I'm going away, and I'm going to send back the promise of the Spirit, a paraclete, one that's going to indwell you, empower you, anoint you, send you forth, guide you. Woo! I don't know about you. I've seen it, and I know this is so wore out. Somebody said, can you go to heaven without the Holy Ghost? And their reply was, I don't even want to go to Walmart without the Holy Ghost. I love that. Amen. I know the Bible says to go to heaven, you must be born again. I get that. I understand you got to be saved. And I can tell you right now, there is another blessing. There is another blessing. There is the promise of the infilling of the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Come on, Spirit-filled people, and say amen. That is a wonderful blessing. That's one of the greatest tools. I'm going to tell you right now, the devil cannot scare a blood-washed, spirit-filled, on fire man or woman of God, young fella, woman of God, when you've got the blessed Holy Ghost. We've got the power of the cross, the victory at the cross. We've got the Word of God. We've got the name of Jesus. We've got the blood of Jesus. Do I need to go on? Amen. Does anybody know that when you fight, you don't fight in your name? You fight in the name that is above every name, that the name, amen. Even the devils know the name of Jesus, and the Bible says they tremble. Anybody read that story where they said, Paul, I know, and Jesus, I know, Paul, I know, and Jesus, I know. They say, who are you? And them devils still say, who are you? But I can tell you right now, they know who you are if you're walking in authority and anointing in the power of God. They know who you are. Power, offensive weapons, prayer, the word, the blood, Christ's victory at the cross, the Holy Ghost. I'm going to close with Ephesians chapter 6. Sister Ellen, if you'll come back, we want to pray just together. We're going to pray. We're going to pray as a group tonight, okay? And we'll take time. If we need to pray, lay hands on. We're not in no rush. But in just a moment, I'm going to read these scriptures. We'll start with verse 10, brother. And I want us just to come. Let's pray together as the army of God. Amen. It don't take many of us. I wish this place was packed from front to back and chairs stuck in the middle. Yeah, but it don't take all them people. John Wesley said, give me five men that know nothing but Christ and him crucified, and I'll turn England upside down. One of the greatest preachers that's ever lived, John Wesley. He said, my heart was strangely warmed by the Holy Spirit. Let me tell you something. People of God, it just takes a handful of people that'll pray, that'll walk in the power and the authority and the anointing that God, they know who they are in God. We're in a battle. Closing with this, would you stand? And I'll read it in your ears. I love this. I love these passages. Finally, my brethren, there's a few key words. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. We just sang about him a while ago, the Most High, all-powerful, omnipotent, all-powerful. Amen. We don't have to do this by ourselves. He said, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Verse 11, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand. This word is prominent in this passage of Scripture. Be able to stand. He said that you may be able to stand against what? The wiles, the tricks, the scheme. That devil is scheming against you. Don't you leave here and think that you're okay. That he ain't after you. He's after you. He hates you, your family, your children, your grandchildren. He hates everything that you're doing. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, against principalities, powers, rulers of darkness,
this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Remember what we talked about Daniel earlier, that battle going on in the heavenlies. You'll see some of it repeated again in the book of Revelation, heavenly things going on and supernatural thing. It goes on. We don't have to see it. Somebody say, I want to see it. I can tell you that somebody that has, God has let see a demon, you don't want to see this. Don't pray that way. And if you're in a season and God uses you in that, then you flow with it and go with it. But we don't pray that way. We pray victory over that. But these things exist. Verse 13. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand. Here we go again. Stand now and withstand in the evil day. And having done all, stand. Does that sound like you sit down and watch TV in the recliner? No, this is a battle, people. This is a battle. Then he talks about, and we go to verse 14. Here we go again. Another key word, stand. They're having your loins girt about with truth, having on the breastplate of righteousness. Now, we're not going, for time's sake, we won't unpack all of this. Having the shield of faith, defensive weapon, so that we can be able to withstand and quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. Your feet shod, let's go back. Feet shod with the, I went back. And you have your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Verse 16. Shield of faith, quench the fiery darts of the wicked, defensive. Your feet, it matters where you go. You got to be careful. You ain't fighting the devil with your feet going to the liquor store. Watch, you got to watch where you go and what you do and where you walk. This is a, I don't know if we sing it here, there's a highway to heaven. None can walk up there but the pure in heart. You know where to get that from? It's a straight and a narrow way. You got to watch. You have your feet shod with the preparation of God's peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith you shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. Go ahead. Helmet of salvation that covers your mind. Sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Verse 18, and this is where we'll close. Isn't it amazing that Paul would wrap up in a nice little bow here, package. In spiritual warfare, he says, praying always with all prayer and all supplication in the Spirit. You pray with words, you pray in the Spirit, you pray with groanings and utterings. Paul deals with this in Romans, with groanings and utterings, which we cannot be understood. He said, watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. Pray, pray, pray. Spiritual warfare cannot be won unless the church prays. I want you, if you would, to come and join me in this altar. If you would, just stand. We're going to pray together. I'm going to pray over you. We're going to pray with each other.